Good morning.
Morning.
I'm Matt, this is Susie, and the hairy one down here is Lola. So it's great to have you all with us on this Sunday morning again. These Sundays seem to have gone a lot longer than we expected when we started doing YouTube and Zoom services. But it's amazing how God equips us, and we're all learning all the time, people in the fellowship who are producing the videos, doing the sermons, the worship. It's been a real progress, and I think God's equipping us for what's going to happen in the next phase of the church's life as we grow. So, great to see you all, whether you're joining us on Zoom or you're watching on YouTube later. It's brilliant to spend time in God's presence. What are we doing first then, Suze?
So we're going to start off with a worship song, and it's going to be Oh Praise the Name.
I
So I've been reading several Bible plans recently, and one of them focuses on Gideon in the book of Judges. In Judges 6, it starts off with Gideon hiding grain in a wine thresher to stop the Midianites taking it. Then an angel of the Lord appears to him and says,
"The Lord is with you, mighty warrior."
So bearing in mind that Gideon is hiding in a wine press at this time, this must have completely shocked Gideon quite a lot. Then the Lord turned to him and said,
"Go with the strength you have and rescue Israel from the Midianites. I'm sending you."
Gideon is so honest with God and says,
"How can I rescue Israel? My clan is the weakest in the whole tribe of Manasseh, and I am the least of my entire family."
And the Lord said to him,
"I will be with you, and you will destroy the Midianites as if you were fighting against one man."
And that's from Judges 6, verses 14 to 16. So Gideon must have been thinking at this point,
"Are you kidding me? The Lord is with me? I don't think so. Not seeing any evidence that God is around or even interested. And a mighty warrior? Wrong guy. I'm scared of the Midianites. Why do you think I'm hiding in this wine press?"
So he's so honest with God, he doesn't hold anything back. And I'm sure for a lot of us, we're doing that quite a lot at the moment.
So like Gideon, there's always something in our lives that may have us cowering in fear. And it may feel like God's abandoned you. You may think that he doesn't seem to hear you or seem to care about you or the situation you're in.
But nothing, nothing could be further from the truth. Regardless of what you may be facing or going through, God sees you right now in this moment and he is with you.
Amen.
So you just embrace the truth that there's never a moment when God does not see you and he is not with you.
It's not an accident that the first thing God uttered to Gideon was that he was not alone. God knew that Gideon felt abandoned. Life was uncertain and frightening under the ruling of the Midianites. He didn't feel strong enough to deal with it, let alone be the person that God was sending.
So whatever trials we may be facing at the moment, we aren't facing them alone. The Bible actually commands us to not be afraid several times in the Bible, 365 times actually, and that's one for every day of the year. So do not fear. God is with you always. And just a reminder of one of those verses, we've got Emily now.
And it's from Isaiah 41, verse 10.
"Then sings my soul, my Saviour God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art."
When through the woods and forest glades I walk, sings my soul, my Saviour God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art.
Then sings my soul, my Saviour God, to thee. And take me home.
shall fill my joy heart. Shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration, and then proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee.
Thank you, Emily. That was brilliant.
And what a fantastic song choice you chose to go with it. So we're going to go over to Phil now, who's going to share today's message. And he's going to look at Solomon's encounter with God. Over to you, Phil.
Hi, everyone. Today we're continuing our series on encountering God. And we're looking at 2 Chronicles chapter 7 and verses 11 to 18. It's the story of King Solomon. He is such a well-known figure, known to many, the third king of Israel, a child of King David and Bathsheba. And whilst he wasn't the eldest son, Solomon was chosen by God to be king. And he came to the throne of Israel with a very specific calling and a task, and that was to build a temple for the Lord in Jerusalem. Essentially, Solomon was to build a house for the presence of God to dwell in. His father David had amassed all the great wealth and materials that were needed to complete this great work. And the plans and the designs for the temple and everything connected to it were passed on to Solomon. It was up to him now to deliver this. And can you imagine the weight of expectation that rested on his shoulders? Not only was his father, the great King David, such a difficult act to follow, but Solomon also had a huge project to accomplish. He was tasked with building a house for God, a temple where the presence of God would dwell. You can understand, can't you, the pressure that Solomon was feeling. He was overwhelmed by the enormity of the task. He was weighed down with all of it. And perhaps self-doubt, perhaps fear of failure. But just at the moment he needed it most, God showed up. And God asked Solomon the most incredible question. What do you want me to do for you? What a great question. Solomon could have asked for anything. It was a blank check. And yet, and this shows the heart of the man, in great humility, Solomon confessed his inadequacy to God, his unworthiness for the task of leading God's people. And he cried out for wisdom, for godly understanding to do the job and to do it well. He cried out to God for help to accomplish this great work. And God was pleased to not only lavish wisdom and understanding upon him, therefore answering his prayer, but he also gave Solomon all that he didn't ask for: wealth, riches, fame, and honor. So Solomon had encountered God before in his early days as the newly appointed king of Israel. And today we pick up his story a little further along in his life. He had now finished building the temple, and it was done. And Solomon as king stood up before the people and he cried out to God and prayed for God's presence, God's blessing, God's anointing. He prayed for God's glory to fall and to dwell there. And it was at this point where he encounters God for a second time. We see at this moment that Solomon's God was a God who responds. Our God is a God who responds. Let's just pick up the story from verse 11. When Solomon had finished the temple of the Lord and the royal palace and had succeeded in carrying out all that he had in mind to do in the temple of the Lord and in his own palace, the Lord appeared to him at night and said, "I have heard your prayer and have chosen this place for myself as a temple for sacrifices." See, Solomon had been obedient, he'd been diligent, he'd worked hard. Over many years, he had been faithful and he had finally accomplished the great task that he'd been required to do. He'd thrown himself into the work of the Lord. And God had demonstrated his glory in a most remarkable way. At the dedication of the temple, the presence of God had come. Fire from heaven descended and the glory of God filled the building. And everyone saw it and it was spectacular. Now you'd think, wouldn't you, that such a public display of God's blessing, such a heavenly affirmation would be enough. But God had heard Solomon's prayer, and it was a big prayer. Solomon asked for nothing short of God himself to dwell amongst his people. It was from the heart, it was full of desire for God and for God's presence and his glory. And God always responds to prayers that desire more of him. It's important for us to understand that true and meaningful encounters with God are not just spectacles for public viewing. They are personal, they are intimate, they are life-changing and transforming. They move us in our innermost being, and God needed to speak and Solomon needed to understand. You see, this was a difficult time for Solomon. After he had built the temple and his palace, he came to a dangerous period of his life, a season after great blessing, great accomplishment. He could have sat back. He could have said, "That's it. I'm just going to enjoy myself from now on. That's me done. I've done what I was asked to do." But it was at that precise moment that God graciously gave Solomon a fresh revelation of himself. Not only did God affirm his blessing on the temple, he drew close to affirm his blessing for Solomon. The building was Solomon's work, done in the power and the inspiration of the Lord. The consecration and the blessing of the building was God's work. Solomon could build a building, but only God could anoint it with his presence. Whatever God asks you to do, whatever God asks us as a church to do, it's not the work in itself that we worship. It is God alone. God is who we worship. It's not the praise of others we seek, but the glory of God. And let us learn today from this story that our service is to be out of pure hearts of love and adoration to God. Let us encounter God and keep him as our focus and our priority. Let's allow him to change and transform us and to work through us. For not only is he a God that responds, he's a God that restores. In verse 14, God says, "If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven, and I will forgive their sin, and I will heal their land. And now my eyes will be open and my ears attentive to the prayers offered in this place. I have chosen and consecrated this temple so that my name may be there forever. My eyes and my heart will always be there. If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face." This is a wonderful promise in the context of God's promise to answer prayer from the temple, which he chose to bless with his presence. God promised something special to his people, that when they humble themselves, when they pray, when they seek his face, God, as the heavenly king, was showing Solomon that a humble heart opens God's blessing. And there's something naturally humble in true prayer, isn't there? Because we recognize that the answers are not in ourselves, they are in God. God promises something special to humble, praying people. Not only did this encounter with God transform Solomon, God extends his favour to the whole nation, that if they will follow the Lord with all their heart, God will forgive, God will heal and bless and be exalted among them. As the people of God humble themselves, as they pray, as they seek his face, they must also turn from their wicked ways. It wasn't enough to merely turn their heart to God. They must also turn their life to God. To acknowledge God as their Lord meant that he was Lord of everything. His restoring power at work in us must produce evidence of changed lives, and his holiness and his purity shining through us must impact who we are and how we live. Encounters with God can never, ever leave us the same. If we are unmoved by encountering God, then there's something very wrong. Notice also in these verses the passion and commitment God declared towards his people. He said, "My eyes and my heart will always be there." And the idea of God having a heart is rarely expressed in the Bible, and there are few explicit references. But it's hard to think of a more intimate way to indicate God's nearness or a greater encouragement for us to pray. Not only do encounters with God show that God responds to our hearts and prayers, they also show that he is working in us to restore and to heal and to change us into a people that reflect his image and his glory. Encountering God truly changes us. And even more than that, we see in this story that he is a God who rewards. In verse 17, it says, "As for you, if you walk before me faithfully, as your father David did, and do all that I command, and observe my decrees and my laws, I will establish your royal throne, as I covenanted with David your father when I said, you shall never fail to have a successor to rule over Israel." The conversation returns to Solomon again, as God addresses him personally. Solomon had done a great work. He poured out his heart in prayer. God had responded personally to Solomon, and he promised restoration to his people. Now he challenges Solomon. "If you walk before me as your father David walked, then I will establish the throne of your kingdom." God's answer to Solomon's prayer had a great condition. If Solomon walked before God in obedience and faithfulness, he could expect blessing on his reign and the reign of his descendants, and the dynasty of his father David would endure forever. God did not demand perfect obedience from Solomon. David, his father, made mistakes and certainly did not walk perfectly before the Lord. But David's heart and desire was to serve and to please God alone. And God told Solomon to walk before him as his father David had walked. This was not out of reach for Solomon. This was not some impossible requirement. This was doable. And how often do we talk ourselves out of truly and unreservedly following God? How often do we excuse ourselves from giving him everything and of holding nothing back? "Oh, it'll be too difficult, but I can't give up everything. There's so much I want to do. Oh, maybe in a few years, Lord." God asked Solomon for his heart. He asked him to walk faithfully and to be obedient to what God required of him. And the blessing of Almighty God would fall upon him. The consequences of holding back on God, of not giving him everything, were detailed in these verses, and they were terrifying for Solomon. With God or without God? Surely without God was not a price worth paying. So what can we learn from this encounter? Well, there are two choices given us when we encounter God. And they're simply this: to say yes or to say no. Maybe later, just another way of saying no. I urge you today to say yes. Yes to more of God. Yes to all of God. Yes to his lordship, his presence, his anointing, his blessing, his favour. There's no better place to be than in a totally loving and committed relationship with God himself. Don't choose you. Choose God. Dare to pray and give him everything. A life given totally to God is a life lived in all its fullness. Begin that journey today. Let's pray. Lord God, more of you we seek. All of you we pray. Give us the courage to give up what we cannot keep, to gain what we cannot lose. Stir our hearts today, O Lord. In your love and your mercy, draw us to yourself. Let us decrease, that we will be nothing, and that you will be everything. You will increase. Fill us with your presence, Lord. Fill us with your glory. Amen.
Thank you, Phil. So we're now going to come together as a fellowship, and we're going to lift our voices to our Father God, and we're going to worship him. We're going to sing a song that we've only just started singing, but it's a fantastic song. It's called Breakthrough.
This song has really impacted so many people recently, and we've heard so many stories about new believers coming to faith with this worship song. So it's just amazing to be able to sing it all together now.
By your power, the oceans open wide, your fire falls down, heaven and earth collide. King Jesus, forever by my side, by my side. Shake the mountains, break the walls apart, open the heavens. Almighty God, you are overcomer, defender of my heart. You have my heart, Lord, by your power. The oceans open wide, your fire falls down, heaven and earth collide. King Jesus, forever by my side, by my side. It's your power and your presence break strongholds, King of heaven. When you speak, mountains move.
It's an amazing song. I can't help but be blessed by it. It's fantastic. We'll just pray now and then we'll finish the service. If you're joining us on Zoom, we'll go into our little rooms and have a chat for 10 minutes. If you're joining us on YouTube, then thanks for coming and we'll see you again next week. Anyone that's joining on YouTube, if you'd like to come to the Zoom meetings with us, interact with the fellowship, you're more than welcome. Just email hello@aynon.co.uk and we'll send you more information. So let's just pray. Father God, as we in Wales go into another, we're in the middle of a 2-week lockdown, Lord. And life seems so uncertain, so strange, and we can't necessarily see the end of it. We pray, Lord, for a blessing over everyone, especially over our fellowship and our small body that's together at the moment, Lord. We pray that you bring us peace, you bring us comfort, you bring us an understanding of what's happening. Help us see you through the situation, Lord. For people who are isolated on their own, we pray a blessing for them. We pray that they manage to reach out to people, that people notice them and see that they're in need. Pray that as a fellowship, Lord, we see people in the community that we don't necessarily normally know or spend time with, but we see the need and the requirement for us to be there, Lord. And help us be bold enough to step out and to be Christ to them.
Yes, thank you, Jesus, that you're with each one of us, that you see us, that you're with us, and we're never, ever alone, Lord. So we just hand the rest of this day over to you, and we just pray for blessing over everybody watching right now. And Lord, we just ask that you just work into everyone's lives. So Lord, we just like to pray for those people working on the front line, doing such an incredible job, Lord. And we just pray for extra blessings on their lives and just thank them for all that they're doing. And Lord, we just pray for the government too, that you have your hand in the decisions that they make, Lord. Thank you, Jesus.
Amen.
Amen.
See you all soon. Have a great week. God bless.
Bye.